When the cranberries were first discovered in the early 90s, they had triggered a bidding war between major record labels and seemed poised for success. But after recording their first album, things seemed a lot less certain. The Cranberries had released their second single, Linger, in 1993 to a disappointing response. Just when the band feared they were about to be dropped by the label, Linger became a surprise sensation in the US. From that moment, the Cranberries were on their way to becoming one of the most important indie pop bands of the decade. You could even say they became the soundtrack of the 90s. You know I'm such a fool for you. You got me wrapped around your finger. Do you have to let it linger? Do you have to... Hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. Welcome back to another episode of the series. If you haven't already, please subscribe. And if you're into production, you can go to Produce Like a Pro and sign up for the email list. Today, we think of the Cranberries as one of the most important bands of the 90s and beyond. But at the start of the decade, they were still dreamy-eyed teenagers playing small pubs and venues around their hometown of Limerick in Ireland. The Cranberries were formed in Limerick in 1990 when singer Dolores O'Riordan teamed up with the brothers Mike and Noel Hogan and drummer Fergal Lawler. About a year earlier, Lawler and the Hogans had formed a group called The Cranberries Saw Us with singer Niall Quinn. Shortly after Quinn unexpectedly quit, he introduced the band to O'Riordan, who was friends with his girlfriend's older sister. O'Riordan was looking for a band that would play original songs instead of covers.
It was Ferg, the drummer, myself and Mike, and we started, I suppose it was around 89, give or take, you know, the kind of, and like the real short version is we bought instruments and started a band because that's what everybody else was doing in town. And we used to go to a lot of gigs and we were just kind of just getting to that age. We were kind of old enough to go to gigs. And but we noticed everyone that was playing in the shows, we knew them. We would have gone to school with them or gone, you know, hung around the same places. And we were really into music, so we started a band. A friend of ours who was in another local band, I bumped into him just by chance, and he was a drummer in that band. He wanted to be a singer. He joined with us for about 6 months. And now we were, as I said, we bought instruments, started a band. So you can imagine how bad we were, you know. I mean, it was awful. But Niall had kind of, he'd been in many bands and we learned a lot from him and how a band should operate with songs and everything. He left and it was through Niall then that we met Dolores. His girlfriend at the time knew Dolores. He met me one day again and he said, look, are you still together? I was like, yeah, it's just all instrumentals. And he goes, well, I know a girl that's looking for a band, but she doesn't want to do cover versions. And we were like, perfect. So Dolores came up, we played, I think it was Linger, like a kind of instrumental version of Linger, and another one or two. Dolores, she sang one of her own songs, and she sang a song called Troy by Sinead O'Connor. And straight away it was like, there's that huge voice and that little person. And, you know, that was it. That became the four piece that everybody knows.
She showed up at the first meeting with a keyboard tucked under her arm, confident that no matter what the first impression would be, she could impress them with her voice. The songs that they had at the time were not my taste, but I saw the potential in the playing. It was easy for me because I knew no matter what their first impressions were, that the minute I opened my mouth, they were going to be impressed.
We played two kind of instrumentals. I think Linger was one of them. And then Dolores sang a Sinead O'Connor song and a song she'd written herself. We got talking and, you know, I gave her a cassette with just kind of me playing guitar of Linger on it. And that was it. She came back the following week. She said, I have an idea for that song. And then we plugged her into the guitar amp. We both shared the one amp. Couldn't old really school. Hear the lyrics. Like, yeah, but you could hear, Christ, she can sing. You know, she really good, and the melody was gorgeous, and that was it. That was the start of the Cranberries that everybody knows.
The band then put together their first demo in Xerox Studios in Limerick. Still teenagers, it was their first time in a recording studio, and they took advantage of all it had to offer, including a Soundcraft desk, a 16-track recorder, and a Yamaha Rev 7. Noel remembers, "We used every track that was available, to the point of sometimes even bouncing tracks. Dolores tended to layer a lot of harmonies, a lot of soprano stuff. We definitely took advantage of this in those early days because the studio was a new toy in many ways to us." The strings on the Linger demo were played on a keyboard, and the band put together the arrangement that everyone now knows. The opening guitar intro, O'Riordan's humming, the different fades as the song moves from section to section, they're all there in the demo. With a popular demo under their belts, the band played extensively throughout Ireland, attracting interest from several major record labels. They eventually signed with Island Records, and by 1992 found themselves in a Dublin studio, recording with producer Stephen Street. I recently spoke with Stephen, who explained...
They were signed by Denny Cordell. Denny Cordell is a producer in his own right from the 60s. I think he did Moody Blues, perhaps, stuff like that. I'm not too sure. English guy, but lived in America. And Denny Cordell also, I think he was instrumental in the path of Tony Visconti. I think Tony Visconti was his engineer for a while on the, you know. Denny was a very well-connected chap. He was quite a well-known, quite upper middle class. He had, you know, all the connections and things. He was quite a dapper chap. Anyway, he signed them, and they were signed to the American side of Island Records, which politically we'll get onto later on, because there was a problem with that, because the people at Island in the UK hadn't signed the Cranberries. You found there was a certain kind of antipathy, I would say, directed towards them. And it definitely kind of hindered, I think, at the initial release of the album. But we'll get on to that. But anyway, Denny signed them. And so it was with him that I had the meeting, because Denny came over to the UK and I went to Island Records to have a chat with him. And he played me a cassette of a few songs. And Lingo was on that. And I think Dreams was on there too. And a few others, you know. And yeah, I was asked whether I'd be interested in working with them. And I liked what I heard. I could tell... You know, they were kind of fans of the kind of Sundays, the Cocteau Twins, that kind of stuff. The kind of thing I thought was interesting, and was definitely kind of, you could see it was connected somehow to the Smiths and the, you know, the things that I'd worked on in the past. So I thought, like, yeah, great. So let's do something. So I said, I'd like to see them live. And so I went along to see them play at the Marquee. At this point, the Marquee had moved from Wardour Street, I think, into Charing Cross Road. I'm not sure if you're familiar. It was a bit larger, and it was therefore a bit cold. Actually, it didn't have the same atmosphere as the original Marquee had. But anyway, I saw them play a gig, and it was in fact that night tapping into the Graham Coxon. I met him before, which I referred to in our last interview. But anyway, I watched the Cranberries play, and they were okay. It weren't brilliant, but there was something there. I mean, Dolores was so nervous as a front woman. She wouldn't even face the audience. She kind of sang sideways on. The crowd were there. She's singing to Noel. You know, it was just like she was really, really nervous about everything. But there was something there. I said to Denny, you know, yeah, I definitely would like to do something. And he said, well, what songs do you want to do? And I picked out Dreams, and I picked out Linger as well. He said, well, I don't want you to do that one yet. I want to let's just hold that one back, and we'll do a test session first, do a couple of other songs, and we'll see how we go. I went over to Dublin, and we worked over there. There was a small studio that was part of the Windmill Lane setup, but it wasn't the Windmill Lane that was down by the docks where you two were. It was a Windmill, I think it's St. Stephen's Green, which is in Dublin. Forgive me, I can't remember the actual name of the green, but it's a rectangular green that's at the top of the high street in Dublin City. And there was a smaller studio there. And in fact, I think Def Leppard had been kind of in situ there for over a year or so. They were in kind of in their tax exile days. And back then, British acts could go and live in Ireland and get, you know, the tax breaks. So it was quite a small little studio, but pretty well equipped. Wasn't too bad. I can't remember the desk. I think it might have been an MCI. If it was, I remember feeling quite at home with it. And I had trained on an MCI when I started at Island Records. And we did a two-week session, and we did Dreams within that session and a couple of other tracks, and took the songs back to Denny who was still in London at that time. In fact, he came over, actually, if I remember rightly. Yeah, he did. He came, he popped over to see how things were going. And it all went great. So it was like, okay, fine, you can do the album now. So we went back in and we did the kind of the longer session, as it were, for about 3 or 4 weeks, I think, to do the rest of the songs. And it was in that session that we did Linger.
For the band, working with Street was a dream come true. They'd ask who they wanted to work with, and he was the one producer who made the top of all of their lists.
We got signed, and we had started, you know that one, Steve, we started the album with a guy who owned a local studio here, and he was kind of managing us at the time, and it just didn't work. We did 3 weeks, and it was, you know, it didn't sound like us. And we parted ways with him, and we'd spent a lot of money at this point, and we thought, you know, the record company isn't really going to go for this. And thankfully, the guy who signed us, a guy called Denny Cordell, was very patient with us and saw the bigger picture. And he kind of just came over and said, who do you want? And we said, Stephen. But to be honest, I didn't think he'd do it. You know, I know you're there now, Steve, but I kind of thought, you know, we were only playing together maybe a year at that point. And, you know, we thought it was kind of a bit above us and probably a bit cheeky to ask. But at the time, I think Viva Hate was out and it was huge. It was, you know, especially in our world, that would have been a big, big deal.
After a trial run recording a few tracks at Dublin's Windmill 2 recording studio, the band returned to the same studio to record the rest of their debut album, Everyone Else Is Doing It, So Why Can't We? Much of the album was recorded smoothly, but Linger did prove to be a bit more difficult.
The one song that did prove to be a little bit difficult was Linger, believe it or not. There's a couple of things that were sticky in that song. One was getting the tempo of it correct and also the groove of it. And then the other thing was getting that transition, you know, that do-do-ding, do-do-ding, that the first part, getting that to kind of cross over nicely and feel natural. And it took a little bit of jiggling about to get that to feel right. But we'd done the track and we'd done pretty much a lot of work to it. And I'm sitting there one day, I'm going, it just feels lumpy. It doesn't feel right to me. There's something not quite right. And it's to do with the bass drum and the bass line in the verse. And I suddenly realized that it needed to swing a bit more. It wasn't quite right. Now, fortunately for this song, what we had done, we had decided on the tempo. And I think we had done, if I remember rightly, just the drums, just, you know, there's a shuffle, there's a snare shuffle, which is going all the way through. And I decided I wanted a little bit of control on that against the bass drum and the cymbals and things. So I got Fergal just to do that drum pattern, the snares on its own. And then we overdubbed the bass drum and the other bits and pieces of the kit. I spent quite a bit of time and I still wasn't happy with how Linger was feeling. So I got Mikey back in and Fergal. I said, look, I think the bass drum's got to go dunk, dunk, dunk. It's got to have a little bit. Dun, dun. It's got to swing a bit because I think it was just going dun, 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 dun. It just felt a bit flat to me and it didn't feel right. So we did that and straight away I thought this is sounding a lot better now. It's swinging a little bit more. It's only a subtle thing, but it did make a difference.
In terms of equipment used for the drums, Stephen recalls that he likely used a Neumann U47 FET inside the bass drum with Shure dynamic mics on both sides of the snare. He also likely had Sennheiser MD421s on the toms, Cam 84 on the hi-hat, and two overhead mics, Neumann U87s. Noel's guitar part was primarily recorded on Fender Telecasters. He used a Fender Twin Reverb amp, as well as a Vox AC30 with its tremolo effect. He credits his favourite pedal for helping create the Cranberries classic guitar sound found on Linger. I had a DOD chorus pedal that I still use to this day. It was the very first pedal I bought, and it's still in my rig because it has a setting on it that's very much the Cranberry sound. So this beautiful song is really straightforward in its chord progression. The F sharp note appears a lot. And what I find beautiful about this is in the four chords sequence, you've got a D, And then you've got this A with an F sharp on the top. And then you've got the C and the G. And what is absolutely lovely about that is that A with the F sharp is usually what guitar players are trying to avoid when we're playing. We don't like to hear that pretty F sharp on the top. So it's really a rather beautiful chord sequence. But let's get stuck into the intro first. So the intro is just a D shape. So it plays like a G major seventh and then a D. It only plays these three notes. So the first chord is this G major seventh. Second chord is a D major. So the main chord sequence driving the song, we talked about earlier, the D, the A with the F sharp, so it's an A6, and then the C, which goes to a major seventh, and then the G is doubled by an electric guitar and an acoustic guitar. So we get this. So this groove is the groove of the song, and we're going to play the suspended second there. And the reason why it's called a sus2 is because there's no major third, so it's suspended over the third. And then, of course, there's famously suspended fourths, but this is a suspended second. If there was a third in there, it'd be considered a ninth chord. So here's the groove. Comes to the C, now it does that same movement, but this time taking the first finger off here on the C note and putting the B in, creating a major seventh. Going to a straightforward G chord. One more time. This is the whole, all four chords in a row. Outside of these guitar parts, there's also a lot of really cool stuff mixed in, where there's some reverse guitar tracks, there's some other kind of overdubs that are really, really super subtle. Some of the key stuff is really beautiful and simple in there. And of course, that great string line. It's a simple, simple melody that Dolores came up with, but it's super hooky. So let's check out some of the other guitar stuff from the multi-tracks. So what I love about this chord sequence is it could be one of two keys at all time, couldn't it? Because you've got D, C, and G, which is the key of G. Or you've got D, A, and G, which is the key of D. So it's a beautiful kind of revolving, rolling chord sequence. You know, I suppose I like to think of it as like honky tonk woman, you know. So I like to think about it like that. It's in G, but they throw in an A. Whichever way you want to think about it, it doesn't matter. It works so well. It's such a great, great song. And it's simple, it's beautiful. It just proves that, you know, theory is a wonderful thing, but using your ear and just putting something together, even in the simplest form like they did here, just works so well. I don't think between them they probably knew anything about 1/4/5s or anything, but they had great ear, and Dolores, of course, wrote beautiful melodies. The instrumentation's simple, the lyrics are incredible, and above everything else, Dolores' voice is unbelievable. One last thing to mention is the beautiful, simple slide guitar part. Let's check it out from the multitracks. The opening was recorded with a cheap Yamaha acoustic guitar owned by O'Riordan. The demo version of the song used electric guitar with a strong flanger and chorus effect on the intro. You can hear the effects make the notes sound out of tune. Street liked the demo's arrangement overall, but after hearing the demo's warbling guitar opening, they switched to an acoustic guitar. The new sound maintained the mystical effect, but without the fluctuations in pitch. O'Riordan's haunting vocals absolutely carry the song. While the song's lyrics tell a common tale of love and betrayal, her lyrics and melody are uniquely hers. The way her voice lilts on the word linger is especially evocative. The layers of her voice on the track also create a mystical atmosphere. In addition to the melody and the soprano harmonies, her voice acts as an additional instrument in the background, singing a beautiful, wordless counter-melody. O'Riordan's voice is a huge element of what separated the Cranberries from the rest of the 90s indie pop soundscape. Her crystal-clear voice captivated audience, and she never hid her strong Limerick accent. In 1995, O'Riordan told Rolling Stone, "People often ask why I sing with such a strong Irish accent. I suppose when I was 5 years old, I spoke with a strong Irish accent, so I sang with one too." This is the hallmark of the Cranberries' talent. O'Riordan and the band never hid who they were and where they came from. In particular, O'Riordan's vulnerability, in her lyrics and in her voice, are the centerpiece of the band's magic. And on Linger, all of the different and fascinating elements of the song's mix work together to showcase O'Riordan's incredible talent. Dolores' lead vocal has compression on it, which exaggerates the breaths, which are almost a percussive element. If you go back and listen to the final mix, you'll hear this breath between every line.
Is that the way we stand? We are lying all the time. Was it just a game to you? But I mean so deep. You know I'm such a fool for you. You got me wrapped around your finger. Do you have to let it linger? Do you have to? Do you have to? Do you have to let it linger?
The final piece of the puzzle was the emotive string part, swelling in the background of the song. O'Riordan wrote the part using a keyboard string effect. Street then sent it to John Metcalf to arrange it for a string ensemble.
And then basically after that, all we had to do on the track was, when we got back to London, was take the part that Dolores had written on a keyboard for the strings, and then get my friend John Metcalf of the Duke String Quartet to score that out for the song. And he added that lovely little kind of tremolo, high tremolo, right at the very, very front, which worked really well as well. You know, it kind of sets the scene for the song. The main, you know, she'd written that, but it was like a solid line, you know, just like a mono line, should I say, you know, whereas John scored it out properly and made it sound, you know, how it should sound when it was, you know.
After the string overdubs were added, Street brought the tracks back to mix at Maison Rouge Studios. Despite creating an incredible album, the first Cranberries tracks released by Island failed to take off in the UK. They released Dreams as their first single in September of 1992, and then sent the full album to journalists and critics for review. Neither the single nor the review sparked very much excitement in the UK, and the band went on to tour without releasing the album. However, the release of Linger in the US changed everything.
There was the problem that we did the demos and they were kind of sent out to everybody. We weren't even signed at the time. And we were trying to kind of get a name for ourselves in the UK. We kind of bypassed Ireland completely. We'd go over and back and kind of tour the UK. So a lot of the press had the demos for a long time before we ever got in to do the album. And Linger was on there. And I know it's a different version and, you know, in mix-wise and sounds and everything. But I think they weren't really that excited about it because this is, to them, was a song that was a couple of years old. And even though the general public may have never heard that, you know, it was just to play something new, you know. And it kind of, the album came out and it didn't really, there wasn't much fanfare about it at all. It just kind of, it came and went and... a few hardcore fans we did have, you know, bought it, but I mean it really, I don't think it got in the top 100. I can't recall the exact figure, but we thought we were going to be dropped. You know, it was back in those days where you know the record company spent money. If they didn't see it back straight away, it was, you know, goodbye. And we genuinely thought, you know, there isn't much life left in this yet, because of, you know, the album not succeeding. And eventually they got us a tour in Europe with a band called Hot House Flowers, which were another Irish band that were, they had done some kind of Eurovision thing the year before and they were kind of big in Germany and Spain and that, and we kind of jumped on that. But nobody had a clue who we were. We treated it more as a holiday than a tour. We did a half an hour every night before them and just waiting for the call to be told that, you know, thanks, but it's over.
I think what saved you was the fact that you'd been signed by Denny Cordell. Mm. And so he regarded it as his pet project. So I think if it had been a junior A&R man that assigned you directly to the record label in the UK, I think what you predicted would have happened. It would have been like, okay, thanks very much, on to the next act. But Denny, I think he kind of felt compelled to kind of give it one more last push, which is kind of what happened, really.
That's it. I mean, Denny, we weren't aware of it, but Denny had kind of sent out the radio pluggers in the States. He kind of gave up himself on you know, the UK and Europe and all that. And he just went to college radio and he sent out the, you know, the Island pluggers, and that was it. I mean, they added up. It sounded like nothing else at the time. And because this is the beginning of grunge in many ways, and we're in there with, you know, string sections and, you know, and a female vocal kind of quite high and, you know, angelic. And it just, I think because of that, it kind of stood out. And we got a call out of nowhere. I mean, not the call we expected. It was the call that, you know, Linger is taking off and drop everything and come to the States.
MTV picked up the band's mesmerizing black and white music video for the song, and college radio stations began playing Linger across the country.
And they went over to America and Linger took off. The record that was completely dismissed and forgotten about by the British public was re-released and became a huge hit. Exactly the same thing. No remixes, nothing. It was just finally people accepted them for what they are.
Linger made its way into the top 10 of the US singles charts and hit the top 15 in the UK. In Ireland, the song would hit number 3. Spurred by the huge success of Linger, the band's debut album would go on to sell well over 6 million copies worldwide. The album would hit the number 1 spot in Ireland and the UK and made the top 20 in the US. The success of the Cranberries after Linger took off in America was meteoric.
When we released Dreams, went out to the radio stations first, and it went like to alternative stations, which is like people like Pearl Jam, Nirvana, that things that wouldn't be like totally mainstream.
Yeah.
And then there's we released Linger, and that was in the alternative first, and then it went over to mainstream, which is like Janet Jackson. You know, those bigger bands like that.
Yeah.
So it was on MTV like nearly every day, and on the radio stations, you walk into a shop, like, come on, you don't get someone see you, like, like, it's mad.
Getting identified all the time over there.
The success of Linger and its album, Everybody's Doing It, So Why Can't We?, was the start of a long, successful, and international career for the Cranberries. The band would go on to record 8 albums together up until the tragic passing of O'Riordan in 2018. Her unexpected death came as the band was preparing material for their 8th album. Using the demo vocals she had recorded prior to her death, the band released the album posthumously in 2019 as their final work together. They called it In the End. The Cranberries have sold over 50 million albums worldwide since their debut and remained incredibly popular with international audiences up until their dissolution after O'Riordan's passing. Their sound evolved over the years, but they maintained their powerful and influential presence. With Linger, the world was introduced to O'Riordan's mesmerizing vocals and the band's singular sound, and the world would never be the same again. So I really hope you enjoyed that. Please check out the other videos in the series. If you haven't already subscribed, please subscribe. And let us know what other songs you would like to know about. The Cranberries, and in particular this song, are hugely important. As you heard from Noel, they were heavily influenced by bands like The Smiths and The Cure and all of these jangly pop bands. And here they were in the early 90s, introducing it in such a unique way with such an incredibly unique and beautiful singer in Dolores O'Riordan, one of the most striking singers to ever live. For me, I particularly love showcasing and talking about such incredible talents that go against trends. When Linger came out in America, it was right at the massive height of grunge. Everything was super quiet verses, a massive, huge, distorted stereo guitars. And then in comes this indie pop band with this incredible singer, just shoving their way into the middle of all of this hugely heavy music. It just goes to show that great songs, great musicianship, incredible production, and above all, an amazing song with an amazing singer can cut through anything. It's a lesson to us all. So thank you, Dolores, for everything you did. Thank you, The Cranberries. Thank you, Noel and Stephen, for being part of this video. And once again, if you've got any other suggestions for songs below, please let us know. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, goodbye.